Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher today is the director of Bible Tracts Incorporated, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. And now for our Bible study, here's our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Welcome, my friend. It is a delight to have you be part of the program today. Thank you for letting me be part of your day. My Bible right now is sitting open to the Gospel of Mark in chapter 16. If it's at all possible, reach over, get your own copy of the Word of God, and join me there. Mark in chapter 16, I'm going to be reading verse 4 in a moment, all right? I hope that your day is already going well. I hope you've already spent time with the Lord in His Word and in prayer. I'm a preacher of the gospel. I am not a geologist. Now, if I were a geologist, I'd be very interested in rocks, in stones, all kinds of rocks. But today, I am interested not in rocks, plural. My focus is on one particular rock. It's that rock that made the door to Jesus's tomb. After Jesus died and was buried, that stone, that rock, became the focus of a whole lot of people in Jerusalem. Jesus' enemies focused on that stone. Our verse here from Mark 16 tells us that some women were focused on that stone. But even more, do you know that God was interested in that stone? Come with me and let's examine the stone that closed the tomb there at Jesus' sepulcher. It was the focus of his enemies. It ought to be the focus of you and I who love him. Come with me, get your Bible, and join me, Mark chapter 16. Since we are talking about women coming to the sepulcher here to anoint the body, rather interesting that the gospel tract that I want to talk to you about today deals with comfort in time of loss. That's the name of the tract, Comfort in Time of Loss. How many people have had their hearts turned by the Holy Spirit to think about eternal things when they have lost a key, dear loved one or a good friend, somebody that really, well, meant a great deal to that person? I've had a number of people that have gone through the veil of death that meant a great deal to me. One of my granddads, I had two of them, obviously, one of my granddads was a great, great man of God, Jasper Smith, my dad's dad. He was a Methodist man, not a preacher, just a man vibrant in the Spirit of God. He loved to say amen. He impacted my life in a number of ways. I remember his funeral very, very distinctly, and it made me think that my grandfather is no longer with me anymore. Where is he now? Well, I knew he was with Christ because I knew the Word of God. So many people don't know where their loved ones are. Here's a great tract, Comfort in Time of Loss, that God has used when during people for people in their time of bereavement to bring them to faith in Jesus Christ. I want to send you this tract. Would you let me do that, please? Now listen, when I get all done, my announcer is going to come on and give some ways by which you can communicate with us. You pick out one of the ways. He'll give you three or four. Pick out one of the ways. Give us your name and address. And when you do that, in the next business day mail, I will send out to you a sample packet of all of our English gospel tracts. All right? One thing my announcer won't give is a text messaging number. I'm going to be interested in your feedback to this broadcast. Would you consider text messaging me? Now, the number to do that I'm going to give here right now as well as at the end of the broadcast. You need to text me the word gospel, G-O-S-P-E-L, to this number. Let me give it to you right now. It's area code 708-515-4086. All right? Text me the word gospel to this number, area code 708-515-4086. I'll repeat that number near the end of the broadcast. Well, Mark 16, just verse 4 today says this, and when they, the women, looked, they saw that the stone was rolled away, for it was very great. You might have thought that now that Jesus was dead by means of crucifixion, that people, especially the enemies of Christ, could now wipe their hands and with glee and pronounce that their work was done. Their work was complete and over. They had instigated the death of Christ. He could no longer do anything to preach or do any miracles that could make them look bad or look ungodly or look hypocritical. Finally, they could rest. Or could they? Chaos. It seems that chaos and confusion were prevalent in Jerusalem right after Jesus' death. The disciples of Jesus, they were dazed. They were afraid. They were cowering in the upper room. The general public was now beginning to hear about the hurried up trials, the illegal trials that had taken place by the Jewish leaders. Too bad they didn't have the internet back then, huh? They could have, all kinds of reports could have been leaked out through the internet about what the Sanhedrin had done, what they had done to break their own laws. Well, the general public was coming to grips with who it was they had shouted about to see crucified. They had shouted, "See Jesus, the healer, Jesus, the feeder of multitudes, to be killed." But what happens now? Now that Jesus is dead and buried, what happens now? The only person that seemed to have had a plan at all, a determined plan at this point, was Joseph of Arimathea. We saw him back in chapter 15 of Mark in verse 46. But now also, though, the enemies of Jesus suddenly become focused on the stone that was the door to the tomb. The enemies of Jesus wanted to keep that stone anchored in place. Why? Well, for three reasons, I think. First of all, let me use some words to begin with the letter M. A movement had to die. Now, if we were to turn over to Acts chapter 5, we find that after Jesus arose and the disciples started preaching at the day of Pentecost, the Jewish leaders met to figure out, what do we do now? A man named Gamaliel warns the Jewish leaders to beware that they are not fighting God. And reminds him that two previous men had each started a movement to overthrow the Roman rule there in Israel. These men, before Jesus, these men had been killed, and their movements had died out with them. The Jewish leaders wanted this Jesus movement, if I could use that term, they wanted this to die out. To do that, they had to keep that stone anchored in place. They were afraid that the disciples may come and steal the body and say that he rose from the dead. So for the movement of Jesus' sake that they needed to die out, they must keep that door anchored. But secondly, their money, that's my second M word, their money was at stake. You remember that old phrase, follow the money? Of course you do. That little phrase simply means that if you want to see who is really behind any particular event, who is really pulling the strings and making the decisions, all you have to do is find out who is made rich from the event. If Jesus is alive, then these Jewish leaders who made a lot of money from the temple worship and the holy day events and so on, if Jesus is alive, even though perhaps he's just thought to be alive because though the disciples were afraid that the disciples of Jesus would come and steal his body, but if people even thought that Jesus was alive, their pocketbooks would be hurt. They had to keep Jesus in that tomb. They had to keep that stone anchored in place. Thirdly, their manner of daily life was at stake. Not only was their movement had to die, not only was their money at stake, but their manner of daily life was at stake. If Jesus' body were stolen, if it was reported that he was alive, then their position of importance would be shaken. Jesus' enemies and their position would be in jeopardy. If Jesus really was alive, not just thought to be alive, not body, stole a minute, if Jesus really was alive from the dead, then their whole way of worship by these leaders would have to change. Unless they kept that stone anchored, they would be forced to deal with Jesus as the real Messiah. And that's something they utterly refused to do. They had to keep that door anchored. Dear friend, the enemies want to keep the door anchored. In a moment, I'm going to ask you if you are a practical enemy of Christ. Let me stop here. What do you think about the broadcast today? Would you text message me? Text me the word gospel. I'm going to give the number twice here. Here we go. Jot it down. If you're driving, don't text while you're driving. But what do you think about the broadcast? Text me the word gospel to area code 708-515-4086. Again, text me the word gospel to area code 708-515-4086. Now, dear friend, do not tell me what you believe in your head about Jesus and his resurrection from the dead. I want you to tell me how that reality, how that fact has altered the way you live your day-to-day life. You see, if you don't want Jesus changing your life, then you had better find a way to keep that sepulcher stone anchored just like the enemies did. Of course, to keep the door anchored because you don't want Jesus changing your life, altering the way you live. Remember I said a moment ago one of my M words was the word money. Oh, so many people don't want their preacher talking about money. Dear friend, if Jesus arose from the dead, if he is bodily alive from the dead, he gets to mess with your life, he gets to mess with your money and tell you what to deal with, how to deal with it. He gets to tell you about giving to your church, how to spend it, what not to spend it on. He's Lord. He is Lord if he's alive from the dead. But so many people, oh, they want to believe in their head that Jesus is alive from the dead, but they don't want a Jesus that messes with their life, changes their life, tells them how to live. Dear friend, if that's you, well, you better keep that door to the tomb anchored in place, but you have just made yourself and enlisted yourself with the enemies of Jesus Christ. You see, friend, if you don't want Christ to mess with your life, you're an enemy. Christ came to give life. He came to change people, to instead of living their lives to please themselves, to live their lives to please the God who made them, who gives them life. God made humanity with life. Man sinned in the garden. Man died spiritually. Man began to practice following his own dictates. And dear friend, that practice will send you right to eternity in the lake of fire. You need a savior. You need a boss over your life. There's only one that meets the qualifications. Jesus, the Son of the living God. If he is alive from the dead, he is boss over everything. You, your family, your finances, your reputation. Have you received him as Savior? If not, he's going to come at the price tag of being your boss. Oh, friend, he's a great boss. He forgives your sin and gives you eternal life.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes, a ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of all of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. That's 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. A faster way to contact us is to go to our website at BibleTracksInc.org. That's BibleTracksInc.org. There you will find more information about our ministry and details on how you can support Bible Tracts Incorporated. Thanks for listening, and may the Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.